Hi, everybody. Welcome to Do You Believe on Paranormal Zone TV. Thanks, everyone, so much for joining us tonight. For all of those who are joining us for the first time, if you would please subscribe to my channel, I'd really appreciate it. And everybody out there tonight, please give my show a like. I'd appreciate that as well. Now, tonight, I'm really excited. I have Mike Ricksecker with me tonight, again, for the, second or third time with Mike. And Mike Ricksecker is an author, a ghostorian, and I'm showing you both of his websites, MikeRicksecker.com and HauntedRoadsMedia.com. And Mike is also a radio show host. So everybody, let's please welcome Mike to the show. Hey, Mike, thanks so much for joining us tonight.
Hi, Noreen. Thank you for having me back on. Always a pleasure to be here with you.
Oh, I love having you on. You're so knowledgeable. Hey, everybody, tonight, Mike and I, the last time we spoke, we picked the Victorian era photography. And we're going to talk a little about other things that are included with that, like post-mortem photography, the hearse, the wearing of the black clothes, the mourning art. What else, Mike?
The length of time they're supposed to wear the mourning clothing. We'll even get into just some macabre things that they did back then. Death was looked upon very differently than we view it today. So it was more up close and impersonal because it was generally handled right there in the home.
Right. Now, before we start showing the post-mortem photographs, I will let you know. I'll let you know so you can either turn off your computer or walk away or whatever. This, to me, tonight is more educational for the viewers. We're giving a little bit on every subject connected to the Victorian era photography, right, Mike?
Yeah, it's kind of a smattering of the types of things that went on in relation to the photography back then.
Right. Now, what is called for us the American Victorian period was an offshoot from the Victorian era, from Queen Victoria's rule from 1837 to 1901 in the UK. So for us, it was the American Victorian period from 1937 as well to 1901. And now, I was telling Mike earlier. Now, first let me tell you that there was the invention of the daguerreau photography in 1839, which made it more affordable for the average middle-class person to have a photography made, a photograph made. Now, when I went to Louisiana, I had noticed that there were these pictures on the walls. We had taken the tour of the haunted plantations in New Orleans. And I had noticed these photographs, these paintings of children. Sometimes there'd be boys, sometimes there would be a little girl. And they all seemed to look alike, like they would have the same type of clothing on. And so what the tour guide told me was that there used to be a man that would walk around the areas, and he would carry with him a portrait already done in oils, because only Micah knows this as well. Only the rich were able to have these oil paintings done. It was very, very expensive. And sometimes these paintings were the only thing that they had of their child that may have passed away. So the man would walk around all these different areas. Several men, and anyway, they would carry with them a case, and they would have these called templates. It was already pre-painted. One would be for a boy and one would be for a girl. And this is similar to what it looked like. I'm showing you the little boy. And he would take out the template, and if it was a little boy, then they would have this clothing on, and he would just paint their face to that particular portrait. And then the same thing with the little girl. they would have the one portrait and they would paint their face on the on that portrait. So then when this other form of photography, the daguerreo became available, it was more affordable for people to have photographs taken, and it was a cheaper method for the middle class, especially for those who wanted to memorialize their passed on loved ones. So Mike, what do you want to add to that?
Yeah, like you said, you know, it was very expensive for, you know, people to have the paintings done back then. I mean, you're talking, you know, an expensive professional painter that would come in, and you'd have to sit for hours upon hours. You know, sometimes it'd be multiple sittings to have these things done, especially if they were, you know, very large. So it was only the rich and affluent that really had these done. So with when the daguerreotype came into practice, and now you're able to do some photography, it definitely made it more inexpensive. I mean, it still wasn't exactly cheap. I mean, you didn't have people running around taking snapshots all over the place back then. But, you know, it would set an image onto silver, and, you know, they were, you know, much smaller than with these big, huge paintings, and, you know, it would take a lot less time to do. And back then, you still had to, you know, sit for a duration of time while the light was captured and imprinted onto there, but it was a heck of a lot shorter period of time than, you know, anything like a painting. So it made it more affordable or more accessible for the middle class.
Mm-hmm. Now also because of the photography, it's not like we have today with the digital photography. And also when Kodak came out with the Brownie, this ended all of this type of photography. But when this photography was being done, they had to be completely still. They could not move, because if the little child or anybody, even an adult, while they're sending this up and they want to snap the picture, if you moved, it was blurred, and it was very expensive to do this photography, so they wanted to do it in one take. So I was able to find, now here's a posing stand. So whether it was a child, now this is also, I believe this might have also been used in post-mortem photography as well as living people for their photography. And as you can see at the very top here, here's another image. At the top, it would hold their neck still, and their body was up against that. And this helped prevented either holding a post-mortem body up or a live person to help them from not moving. Here's another image. Now this one happens to be a live person. And see how that stand, you don't have, hey Mike, I guess you don't see the internet, huh?
Yeah, I've got the 30-second delay, so I'm on the...
Are you watching?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that. Okay, so here Mike, see, this is that stand I was showing. And this would, and this is a live person, how they would do it. This was so interesting, I thought.
Yeah, no, it's definitely very interesting. You're absolutely right that they had to remain very still. So sometimes they use things like this in practice just to keep the person, you know, steadied in order to take the picture. You know, and that's why a lot of these older photographs, you know, people, you know, that don't know will remark, well, you know, they look all sad and depressed, but really what it is you didn't smile because you couldn't hold a smile that long.
Exactly.
It would hurt your face and your mouth would move, and so you just maintained a straight face.
Oh, exactly. And then here's another image, Mike, of the stand. Now this was like a table. They also used a table, and look at, see, they could make the, it was a table, see where the little boy is resting, or they could pull it up. They could make it taller as well. I really thought this was interesting, because the last time I had talked about this, I only found one image of the stand, and I was really excited to find these images.
Good finds. I don't see the table yet, but
should be coming up. Yeah, there it is. See it?
Yeah.
And you see the boy in the picture, how he's resting against it?
Yeah, he can raise or lower it.
Right.
Depending on it. Yep.
I thought that was awesome. All right, so, you know, the Victorians loved their photography. They loved it. They were amused by it. They would do trickery. Now, there was also, at this particular time, spirit photography, and they
right.
also used
Presume.
Painted
spirit photography.
Yeah, spirit photography and painted backgrounds. So this is crazy. This is one of their many trickery photography photographs. And I don't know how they did that, Mike. I have no idea how they did that.
With which one?
This is the with the cut off head. I don't know how they did those. Oh, it should be cutting off.
Yeah, as far as the cutoff heads, I mean,
here it comes.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if they're using a couple of different plates or, yeah. Okay, I see it now.
It's crazy, but they loved doing this kind of stuff. They loved it.
Well, it was new technology, and they could, you know, trick people into believing that it was real because. You know, back then people hadn't seen images like this before. So, you know, anybody with a little know-how on that type of technology, you know, could start to trick people.
Yeah. Let's see.
The thing that we do now with Photoshop. I mean, this is historic Photoshop is what it is.
Yeah, exactly. But I don't know how they did it. That is just amazing. Look at this one with all these soldiers with their heads off. That's crazy.
Yeah, I mean, it could have something to do with multiple exposures. I know that's how the, and I know we're going to get into it here in a little bit, that's how Mumler did his spirit photography, is by using double exposure. So anybody fooling around with that type of exposure could do some different tricks like this.
Right, and I'm going to show that to them right now. And actually, the one I'm showing to them now, this is considered spirit photography. And do you want to talk about William Mumler on that?
Yeah, William Mumler, he started using double exposures to portray spirit photography as if, you know, there was another person that was there. So he would take it... a previous exposure of somebody and then do another exposure of himself. And that's how he came across as he did. It was basically himself and his cousin. And then he discovered this, like, oh, well, it looks like a ghost in this picture. And the one you have here is Abraham Lincoln behind his wife. And he had already been assassinated by then. And he was actually taken to court and sued for this type of photography by other photographers at that time because they believed that he was giving photography a bad name and they didn't want the reputation of other photographers darkened. However, he actually won the case. Even though they proved in court, well, you know, this is how you do a double exposure, he actually won the case because there were enough people that came forward that had this photography done that insisted that, no, this was truly a picture of their loved one that had passed. And so he was actually acquitted, even though the photographs have been pretty much proven to be fraudulent.
Right. Now, that one with Mary, his wife, and Abe Lincoln, that was one of his most famous images.
Yeah.
Okay.
Definitely.
Let's see. All right, now here's an image with a painted. Now, unfortunately, these aren't in color, but I bet I can imagine that the backgrounds were beautifully painted. This is a typical painted background that they would use. And then here's another. Some of these pictures are really dark. Here's another one. This looks like a painted screen in the back.
Yeah, any of the painted backgrounds are really beautiful. It's almost kind of like the old movie sets where they would paint the background. You have these elaborate landscapes that were painted. for the different scenes. And so, you know, it's like the artwork of the photography within the artwork of a painting, which is you know, really beautiful.
Oh, yeah. Can you imagine if these were in color?
Oh, it would be fantastic. All right. They could do like a little bit of color with a tintype. You could make the cheeks a little rosy if they use tintype photography.
Yeah. Okay, so now our next topic on Victorian photography, it's what they called hidden mothers.
Right.
Now, Mike, do you want to talk about that? Or?
Yeah, it's kind of interesting because they did it for both the living and the post-mortem photography, because you would have, you know, usually for a child, they wouldn't want to sit still, so you'd have a drape or a cloth that was put over the adult, and then the child would be sat in their lap and they'd hold them straight. So you don't really see the mother. You might see, you know, maybe a hand, or you might be able to see a figure. Okay, I see the ones that you have posted here. Yeah, the one looks like a, you know, hooded shroud in white, and the other you can kind of just see the hand poking out from the curtain. So, and these were definitely used a lot in the post-mortem. And then sometimes for the living, if they couldn't hold the child still, they would do things like that. So yeah, sometimes you can kind of see a, you know, shape of a figure, or you can see like the one here, a hand kind of protruding through. So yeah, in some of these older pictures, you can kind of find the hidden person.
Right now, and now, to us, it's creepy as heck. But
the one looks like a ghost.
I know, but in the Victorian era, this was acceptable.
Right.
This is what they did. Here's another one.
Yeah, that one there is pretty blatant. I don't know. We have the 30-second delay, so I don't know what they're seeing. But yeah, this one actually looks like a black shroud over the white. She's wearing a white dress, or maybe a light gray or something. Probably a bad color combination choice there.
Yeah, you know, they used to, usually it was the mothers holding the child up, but I believe they did use fathers as well.
Yeah, the one looked like a father's arm that was kind of sticking out.
Now, as far as the Victorian era, I believe it was mostly in the southern states, wasn't it, Mike, when it started? It was mostly in the southern states, the Victorian era, American Victorian?
Well, I mean, I wouldn't restrict it to southern. I mean, because it was a style. I mean, maybe the type of living, but there was, you know, a whole Victorian style as well, like architecture. You see old Victorian houses all over the north as well. So I don't think it was restricted just to the south. Maybe I'd have to look that up if it got its start there in the United States, but certainly it was all over, at least on the eastern side of the country.
Well, also too, San Francisco. All San Francisco is Victorian houses.
Yeah.
All right, so now we're going to talk a little bit about cabinet cards.
Okay.
Okay, so let me get, do you have your notes on that?
No, you have the notes on that.
Okay. All right, well, oh gosh, hold on for a second. Well, I can tell you that these cabinet cards, I love you, Mike. All right, these cabinet cards were, you know, when they started doing this, they started putting it on paper. And it was thin paper. So then what they did was they put it on a thicker piece of paper, like cardboard stock. And this way, they could send these photographs through the mail. And then they also used them in their parlors. As a guest came over or a relative came over, they were able to give them a card. And eventually they were also called visiting cards and parlor cards.
Right.
So, and this is how they did that. And all of these, as you can see, are on nice card stock, and they're from all nice photographers' studios.
What's really interesting about these type of cards, because you'll see underneath where, I mean, it's blatant advertising. They have the photographer's name and usually the city that they're in on that. And, you know, if you're doing any type of, like, genealogy search, and I had to try to do a little bit of this, was we have this large album of these type of cards of my great-grandmother's side of the family. But there's no names that are associated with any of the people. But the one thing that we've managed to do is actually track down the photographers that created the cards and the photographs to get an idea of when the photographs were taken, to try to narrow down who some of these people may be.
Yeah.
But a tip for anybody doing genealogy.
Now, this invention became popular in, it was in 1854, and they also called it cardomania. And this allowed them to make multiple prints with that thin paper. And then again, it became known as visiting cards. And then in 1870, it became cabinet cards. And this remained popular until the 20th century, then Kodak.
Up until at least the 40s. So I've seen them that late, at least.
Yeah, well, they said the early 20th century, because then Kodak invented the Brownie.
Yeah.
And then that changed everything with photography. Okay. So now... Oh, no, I don't want to do that yet. No. Well, should we do the post-mortem now? Because then we'll go into the mourning and the clothes and all that.
Oh, the mourning's after all of that. Okay.
All right, so listen, for those of you who are watching the show, we're going into post-mortem photography. And if you don't know what post-mortem means, it's photography of those that have passed on. And these post-mortem photography... It was a memento. It was also called memento mori, and it was the practice of photographing the recently deceased. And the earliest post-mortem photographies are usually close-up of the face or shots of the full body. And it really rarely included the coffin, although I did find some that included the coffin.
Yeah, there were... it kind of depended... where you were located in the era, because there seemed to be, at least from my research, it seemed to be kind of, as the years went on, different times in which it'd be fashionable to have the coffin, and other times where it didn't.
All right, now I'm showing one, and as you can see, he's sitting there with the stand behind him, and I've pointed arrows. Now this is a deceased body. He's having his photograph done, and you can see the arrows where this stand is holding up the body. And again, this is a posing stand, and this is how it was done.
Yeah, this is one of the nicer pictures, because there's a lot of, when it comes to post-mortem photography, we can go into a little bit of the history of that, actually. There's a lot of, children, a lot of child pictures within here, and basically it's because photography was still basically in its infancy, and it was still pricey to have these things done. This was going to be the only time that you'd be able to capture an image of your loved one who has just passed away, and so you'd get a photographer over to take these photographs so that you can remember. And a lot of times, again, children, what your loved one looked like. So, some of them are really quite sad. They'll pair up siblings with each other, or a mother holding a child that's passed on. It's definitely very sad, but it was simply because it was still rare to have those photos done. It's not like today where you're in the hospital and one of the things that you do while you're there is get the baby picture done. That didn't exist back then. Life happened in the home, and this was a photography was a luxury.
Oh yes. Now there's a picture I'm showing, and I see. Okay, so the first one I showed were two little girls, and you can clearly see the stand that's behind them, that's holding. And I see two stands, Mike, but I think only one of them is deceased.
Yeah, that could be possible.
And then here's another one of a young man, and
yeah, the boy may be living, because I mean he looks kind of very casual.
Yeah, I'm not sure. You know, it's so hard to tell with their faces. You know, so I'm not sure if he's living or passed on.
I see what you mean. The one looks like she may have passed.
Yeah. Then, okay, now here is an instant where it's a young baby, and then you can see in the background where the mother or father is in black holding up the child for the picture.
Okay, I'm not at that photo yet. But yeah, and we were talking about that earlier, where you know, with the hidden mothers, where okay, yeah, and you can definitely see behind there, yeah, that's a hidden mother, and you can also see with the hands, the baby's hands are tied together on that one.
And do you notice, Mike? Do you notice that in these pictures they cross the legs of the dead ones?
They'll do that sometimes too.
Yeah, I've noticed that in these pictures that I was looking at. Now, also, they would surround the deceased with flowers, and that was to help eliminate the smell.
Yeah, they would do that with the flowers. That would definitely help with the smell. Also, sometimes they put the deceased person with, you know, favorite items. Like there's one that I've seen.
I have it right here.
Her picture.
Yeah. Here's like, a little girl with all her dolls.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. So yeah, they almost have her looking like a bigger doll with all the other little dolls there. I've seen another one too, where they set up the guy's dogs next to him. So,
oh yeah, I've seen that. You know, also, and also to enhance these photographs, they would also prop up the eyes. They would prop the eyes open, or they would also paint pupils on the photograph itself. I guess after it was printed or before it was printed.
You have a decomposing body, and so sometimes the eyes would be off color. So they, sometimes they would paint them. There was ones that are really creepy looking where they didn't paint them, and so those are definitely very creepy looking. And then sometimes you can tell the eyes are being held open. There's one there that it looks like a surprised baby that I've seen, and the eyes are like really wide open.
Oh, yeah, I saw that one.
They would set them up sometimes looking like they were sleeping. They would do that a lot.
Also, so
it's really sad.
Yeah, also, too, they would also, on these photographs, put a rosy tint on the cheeks.
Yep, they could do that with the tint type photographs. So, yeah, they'd have them looking like they're sleeping, or sometimes they would use the devices and just make it look like they're sitting at a table or something like that.
Yeah, and here's another picture of this one, he is deceased, because you can see that in the background, someone is holding his head up. And the stand is right behind him.
The stand is there. The hand is there.
You
have a curtain that's right there, so somebody is obviously standing right behind there.
Right. You could clearly see that.
Yeah. So, but this is, if you think about it, this is the only photograph that they're going to have of their child. So that's why they've done this.
Yeah. Can you imagine? That's the only photograph they would have.
Yeah, that's it. And so we have a hard time imagining that today. Like, if you're taking, photographs of dead people, well, this is the only way to remember what they look like. Just to get like we already talked about, the paintings back then were extremely expensive, and you weren't running around with a camera taking snapshots all the time. It exists back then.
And, they also used to They used to take pictures with their pets too. Their passed on their pets that passed away.
Yep.
Now, okay, I'm going to show a picture. So, and this, and the reason I'm showing it is because this is part of Victorian photography. And for those of you who don't want to see, this is a dog with the family, and they've taken a picture with their dog that has passed on. So I'm going to give you a second to either turn away or do whatever. But for those who are interested in this type of photography, this is a photo, and I've seen several of these, like Mike said, but this is a pet that has passed on. So I'm going to show it, guys. So if you want to please turn away, please do so. When I saw this, it upset me, but this is the way of life. It was the way of life in those days. This is how it was. And this picture is something that they will always have. Them, the family, with their dog that they loved. Okay, so now we're going to move on to the mourning, the clothing, some portraits, and some mourning art. And it's mourning, not M-O-R-N-I-N-G. It's M-O-U-R-N-I-N-G, mourning. All right.
Grieving.
Yes, good. Thanks, Mike. All right, so sure. This picture I'm showing, Mike sent me this. And this is a portrait of Mike's relative. So, Mike, you want to tell us about that?
Okay, yeah. What's kind of interesting about this is you'll notice, and I guess maybe, Noreen, you didn't get some of the other photos that I sent, because I was going to point this out in another one. He's the one guy there, which actually is a great uncle, is holding a photograph of somebody that's passed on. So this is another way, you know, we're taking a family picture, and to include somebody that has passed on within this family picture, they would actually hold up a photograph of them. So it was kind of interesting about this, and Noreen and I were hashing it out a little bit last night, is that the guy who's holding the picture, he's wearing a lighter color, looks like maybe a light gray or something like that, when everybody else is in mourning clothes. Now the two down at the bottom in like a whitish, that's kind of okay if they were younger. If you were younger, you didn't necessarily have to wear the dark colors for mourning. There's, you know, kind of a, you know, depending on who you were, if you were the widow, you'd have to wear black for 2 years. You know, if you were a little bit more indirect, you'd be in here, and you know, kind of scale it back depending on how far back you get removed from the person that passed away. But if you were younger, you didn't have to wear the dark colors. What else do we want to talk about with this? Oh, I have three grandfathers in this, by the way. The young guy off to the, just a note, the young guy off to the right is my grandfather's great-grandfather. And the one directly in the middle would be his great-great-great-grandfather.
Wow.
So, yeah, it's... kind of cool. They were in Mansfield, Ohio at the time. Not sure how far from where the reformatory ended up being built, but yeah, it's just kind of interesting to note how everybody's in mourning. The only thing I can think of why he might be in a lighter color is he might have been traveling at the time. That particular gentleman lived out in Kansas at the time, running the Ricksecker Cigar Company. So he might have been traveling, didn't have the appropriate colored clothing. Not sure.
Wow. You guys had a cigar factory?
In Kansas, his line did, yeah.
Wow. All right, so now I'm going to show you a picture of this is a portrait of a family in mourning, and this is typical of clothing that they would wear during the mourning period. Mike, do you want to talk about the mourning period?
Yeah, we can talk. Well, yeah, since I've already been talking about that a little bit. Yeah, basically, during the Victorian period, you know, there was like a very lengthy process to carry this out, and that's basically because Queen Victoria, when her husband died, she went into mourning for a very long period of time. had, you know, numerous ceremonies to commemorate her husband's death, and you know, was basically obsessive. She was basically obsessive over her husband's death. So basically, because the queen was doing this, you know, everybody basically had to follow suit. You know, we covered a little bit about the the color scheme, the years. I'm trying to think of what else. I have a few notes here. Children were for, or parents of the children would be for like a year, grandparents and siblings 6 months. The other thing was even types of fabric mattered. There was a particular type of fabric called crepe. It was almost like a paperish type of fabric that really didn't go with everything else. But during the mourning process, they would attach it onto these mourning dresses. And as you got toward the end of the mourning process, you would take this, what they call crepe, off. And that would be called sliding the mourning. So you're kind of easing out of it. And you could, you know, as your mourning was ending, then you'd switch up from being in black all the time to like gray. I guess, Noreen, you said you found a purple.
I read purple as well, was incorporated with those colors.
Yeah, and then you basically end up in a white by the end of it.
Well, okay, let me see what I have on that. Now my notes say that young children were often put in white, but trimmed in black or gray.
Okay.
And even their dolls. They even did that with their dolls.
The dolls, okay, I didn't find that. That's a good find. That's interesting.
All right, now what I have, Mike, if you don't mind, if I just kind of read this, the mourning rules for women: they were not allowed to leave the house unless you were wearing all black and a mourning veil. If you can't afford a new black mourning dress, then you would dye whatever color dress you had to black, and then they said, well, you could always dye it back, but you know that there's no way. And the material had to be low luster. And then after 1 year, you could feel free to add some jewelry and maybe a few frills to your black wardrobe for the next 9 months. Now you're in what is called a half mourning mode. And purple is usually the acceptable color, maybe some mauve as well.
Okay, yeah, I had mauve on the list.
And then after 9 months is up, you can start adding some other color back into your life. Then there are different levels of mourning. The husband, the husband or wife is 2 to 2.5 years of mourning. The child that is under 10, they mourn for 3 to 6 months. And if a baby had passed, then you would mourn for 6 weeks. When a child dies over 10, the mourning is 6 months to a year. For parents, it's 6 months. Aunt and uncle, 3 to 6 months. Grandparents, 6 months. And a distant relative, 3 weeks. And then it also says, don't leave home without mourning jewelry. Pieces were typically made out of, I have something. Now, they said typically pieces were made out of black, but I have a piece of jewelry that's of a gold color, and the cheaper materials would work for your jewelry. Hair jewelry became very popular during this time. They would take a lock of your dead loved one's hair and use it in a brooch or weave it into a fancy design, which I'm showing here. Sometimes hair would be braided and made into necklace or bracelet with a locket, and then also with a picture of the dead person inside of the locket. Now, Mike, I have something here that I never saw before. This here is a portrait of the deceased family, and surrounding it are all the locks of hair made into art. And then it's been framed.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I found that.
It hasn't popped up yet, but right now it's at that brooch that has the hair in it. Oh, okay, here we go. Wow.
Is that crazy?
That's pretty crazy. That's really interesting.
I never saw that before.
I haven't seen something like that before. But it's not surprising, because that was a practice that they did back there back then, was keeping the hair like that. I've just never seen it as a whole family.
No.
I've seen the Post-Mortem pictures of the whole family, but not like this. This is different.
And I've never seen that. And then this is a typical picture of hair weaving of the deceased, and I've seen this kind before, where they'll just weave flowers, you know.
Yep.
And now, also part of the mourning is they would drape a black piece of material over the portrait of the deceased one.
Yeah, that was common custom to cover any portraits that you may have in the household.
And then also they would cover all the mirrors.
Yep.
Then they also had professional mourners. Now, from what I understand, these professional mourners would usually be mutes. Is who they would hire mutes to do this.
But I guess because you know that they're going to be silent, that was kind of the purpose.
I don't know. And then, now I have another picture of professional mourners, but I have a feeling that this might be from Europe rather than America.
Well, that's fine.
Oh, you know what? You know what would be a good time now? Is to talk about the superstitions.
Oh, we could talk about some superstitions.
Yeah. Want to talk about some superstitions before we go on further with that? Their superstitions were... I read that they don't know where these all came from, Mike. Do you know how superstition started in the Victorian era?
Well, I mean, superstitions are based, anything starts from, rumors. I mean, even back then you had, all the vampire superstitions and things like that that came out of that time. That mostly started in Eastern Europe. But we hadn't talked about it yet. So what were the superstitions that you dug up?
Okay, what I have is, it's bad luck to meet a funeral procession head on. If you see one approaching, you have to turn around. And if this is unavoidable, hold onto a button until the funeral passes. I know.
Yeah.
Then,
funeral, right.
Then stop the clock in the death room, or if you don't, when they pass on, you have to stop the clock, and if you don't, you'll have bad luck.
Then, that one there is actually a little silly. I mean, I've heard that one before, and there was actually a practical purpose for that. And the practical purpose was to basically acknowledge the time of death.
Oh, that makes sense. That makes sense, Mike.
Yeah.
Let's see. If you hear a clap, these are just samples. I mean, there's tons of superstitions. These are just a small collection. If you hear a clap of thunder following a burial, it indicates that the soul of the departed has reached heaven. Have you ever heard that one before?
I haven't heard.
Oh, no. Oh, my God. All right, so hold on, guys. My laptop turned off. Hold on. I'll get Mike back in a second. Hold on. Hey, I just want to tell you guys, too. Listen, after this show, I'm going to get Dave and Carissa Fleck up on Skype, and he's at the Valeska house. He's doing an investigation tonight at the Valeska house, and we'll tell you where to go for that live investigation tonight. So just stick with me after the show, and I'm going to be getting Dave up on the on Skype, okay? So stick with me. My computer went off. My Macintosh does this. I don't know why, but it'll be starting up in a second, so hold on. So I'm really excited to get Dave up on the computer. Okay, come on, Mike. I'm sorry. If you're watching, Mike, my Macintosh went off. It usually doesn't do this during the show. It usually does it before the show starts, and I'm really sorry. So it's restarting, Mike. So hold on, honey. Hold on. Don't go anywhere. I'm going to have this checked. It never did this during a live show before. Sorry, guys. Sorry. All right, hold on. Hold on. All right, let me get my back. All right, hold on. All right, come on. Here we go. Where's Mike? Here we are. Oh, gosh, come on. All right, here we go. Oh my God. Sorry, Mike. My computer turned off.
Oh, it happens.
All right.
Technology for you.
Well, I've been having problems with my Macintosh. All right. So, what, honey? Oh, okay. So, let me finish this. Okay. So, another superstition. If you don't hold your breath while going by a graveyard, you will not be buried.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
When we were kids, we used to do that too. You'd be riding past a long cemetery. Like,
oh my goodness. Let's see. If the deceased has lived a good life, flowers will bloom on his grave. But if he was evil, only weeds will grow. I never heard that one before. If you smell roses when no one is around, someone is going to die.
Hmm.
I don't like that.
No, I haven't heard a lot of these.
If you see yourself in a... Oh, now this one I've heard before. If you see yourself in a dream, your death will follow. I've heard that. Have you heard that one before?
I have, but you know, I've seen myself in a dream before and it hasn't happened. I mean, well, if you think about it, your death is always going to follow at some point. We all die, so...
Well, I used to hear that one. If a sparrow lands on a piano, someone in the home will die.
Huh. I've heard that one.
Okay, listen to this one. If a picture falls off a wall, there will be a death of someone you know. And then the last one, a single snowdrop growing in the garden foretells death.
Okay. Yeah, those are interesting ones. I haven't heard a lot of those.
And, let's see, what else? All right, why don't we go into now, okay, embalming.
Okay.
Now, I saw somebody in the chat room say embalming started with the Egyptians. Well, it did, but tonight's show we're talking about embalming in the American Victorian era.
Yeah, all the methods kind of changed over the years, so that's fine.
All right, so let me just read this, Mike, okay?
Yeah.
Okay, embalming caught on in the United States during the American Civil War as a result of sentimental issues involving foreign officials and servicemen dying far from the home and the need for their remains to be returned home for a local burial. This period started at about 1861 and is known as the funeral period of embalming. And this is marked by separation of the fields of embalming by funeral directors and embalming for medical and scientific purposes. And Dr. Thomas received a commission by the Army Medical Corps to embalm the corpses of the dead Union sold officers to return to their families. And military authorities also permitted private embalmers to work in the military-controlled areas. The passage of Abraham Lincoln's body home for burial was made possible by embalming, and it brought the possibilities and potential of embalming to a wider public notice. Now, until the early 20th century, arsenic was frequently used, but then they decided not to use arsenic anymore, because if there was somebody that wanted to kill someone by arsenic, then that person would say, "Oh, well, you just put too much arsenic in the deceased body." So in 1867, the German chemist August Wilhelm von Hofmann discovered formaldehyde, and whose preservative properties were soon discovered, and which became the foundation for modern methods of embalming and replacing previous methods. So I'm showing now is some embalming fluids, Mike. And now I'm showing an embalming table.
Yeah, right now I see the bottles. I love the old bottles.
Oh, yeah.
And then once an embalming table pops up. Now I've seen, pretty cool. One of the houses I used to investigate quite a bit in Oklahoma has a embalming table right in the entrance hall. I had a lot of older ones.
Oh.
Right there.
Now I'm showing some pictures of embalming kits that I was able to find.
Oh, okay. Well, I guess we'll look at that. But yeah, it's interesting with the. Yeah, because that's a. That one folds up. You can see the hinge in the middle?
Yeah.
On that table?
Yeah. And also. The embalming was done right in the home. And I came across a historic home, and in this historic home, it was a museum as well, and they're showing us here what a typical embalming room in the house would look like. And this is part of a museum. So I thought that would be interesting to show the viewers.
Right in the parlor there.
Yeah, right in the parlor they would do that. Well, that's where they would usually lay the bodies out too. Now, this is something I didn't know. Before embalming, they had what they called ice caskets. Now,
right, dug that up. That was kind of interesting.
Yeah. So I guess. Oh, I know. I think I did read this before. Because before embalming was there, they would have the bodies in their house, and they would put ice in it to help preserve the body. And that's when they would put flowers all surrounding the casket as well to help with the odor.
Have flowers, okay. Yeah, and it would hide the ice too.
Right. So I thought that was really interesting. I've heard about that, but I never saw an ad for it before. And this was from New York.
Oh, okay.
The ad's from New York. All right, so now I'm just going to show you some pictures of Victorian hearse. And they had all kinds. Some were elaborate, depending on how much money the person had.
Yeah, the old school verses are pretty interesting, especially the horse-drawn ones.
Now, this one with the this elaborate one, I read that this was the one that carried Abraham Lincoln.
Okay, I haven't gotten there yet.
Yeah, the lovely 30-second delay.
Yeah, and you notice in these the horses are shrouded.
Yes. Yes, I forgot about that, Mike. Yes. Boy, how times have changed.
Oh, yeah. We still have hearses, but they're not, elaborate like this.
Oh, no. And in fact, a lot of the hearses don't even have windows in it, so you can't see the casket from the outside. But yet in the Victorian era, they wanted to see the casket. It was exposed.
Right, because it was all elaborate. You wanted to be able to see this. It was all very ceremonial.
Yes. And I think, too, with these processions with the hearse, people were walking. They would walk with the casket in the carriage.
Yeah, it would be almost like a parade. And that's, kind of going back to what, Queen Victoria was doing with her mourning, was that she would have these elaborate ceremonies and parades like this because of her grief for her husband dying.
Oh, yeah.
So they were just basically mimicking her.
So does anything, Mike, do you want to add, is there anything you want to add to this?
As far as the hearses?
Or anything. We're going to, okay, Mike is dying to do this.
Oh.
We're going to.
You talked about embalming, so it kind of plays right into it.
Okay, so Mike is, this is, Mike wants to do this. This is our next topic, and Mike's going to talk about this, and I have a few pictures on John Wilkes Booth, and my God, I never heard this before. So Mike, go ahead.
Well, there's a couple stories. We can start with John Wilkes Booth since he's the most notorious. The other one is just kind of almost really ridiculous. But with John Wilkes Booth, there is a conspiracy theory that he was not killed in Virginia when he fled out of Washington, that he actually escaped and made his way westward into Texas for a long period of time, in Granville, Texas, where he did, perform, but he also worked as a bartender, and then ended up in Enid, Oklahoma, where on his deathbed, he confessed to being John Wilkes Booth. And he was actually committing suicide at the time. So after he passed, they put out his body, trying to find people to claim it. And they also made known that he had claimed to be John Wilkes Booth. Well, there was a man that he had met when he was in Texas that had also been confided to that he was John Wilkes Booth and held the secret. He was a lawyer. His name was Finnis Bates. And so when he heard that this person had died in Enid, Oklahoma, and was planning to be John, he came to check out the body and did identify it as the man that he had known in Texas. Little side fact, Finnis Bates is actually the grandfather of the actress Kathy Bates. So he claimed the body and then took it to the 1904 World's Fair in St. Louis and put it on display basically as a sideshow, as here is the mummified body of John Wilkes Booth that had been mummified for a year at that point. And the guy who had it in Enid, Oklahoma, basically put it on display kind of like that. I guess that's a blown up picture of it. And just kind of, let it sit there for somebody to come by and claim it. And so Bates claimed it, and the World's Fair is basically the biggest venue that he had it up on, and he traveled around with it for a while as a bit of a sideshow. I know that, I think it was the 1930s, Henry Ford was interested in acquiring the body. I'm not sure if he actually got it or not. The last time I recall it being seen was in the 1970s, and they actually did a scientific examination of this mummy, and they did identify that some of the different wounds that it had, like the broken leg and things like this, because broke his leg when he jumped out of the balcony after shooting Lincoln, that this guy did have that broken leg. They would not confirm it as being John Wilkes Booth, because there is a grave where there's that's supposed to contain John Wilkes Booth. Mm-hmm. Another interesting side note was that the guy that was David E. George, The guy that was supposed to have killed John Wilkes Booth, Sergeant Boston Corbett, he actually, in a twist of irony, ended up living and dying in Eden, Oklahoma, where David E. George died, and claimed to be John Wilkes Booth. So kind of interesting how the paths kept crossing in the tale.
Mm-hmm. Well, I also have some information on that. And at the time, the Saturday Evening Post magazine reported that nearly every showman who had exhibited the mummy, and here's the mummy, had been financially ruined.
Yeah, the curse of the mummy, sure.
And in 1930, the carnival man, John Harkin, and his wife bought it for $5,000. And the Harkins traveled all over the country in a battered truck with the hollowed mummy, and his eyes were all hollowed out. And Harkin promised $1,000 to anyone who could prove that the mummy was not Booth, and he said that he never paid out a dime. Then in 1931, a group of Chicago doctors, including the city's health commissioner, x-rayed and examined, like you said, the corpse. And they thought that, yes, it was John Wilkes Booth.
Yeah.
Then in the beginning in 1937 and continuing into 1950s, the mummy was a part of Jay Gould's Million Dollar Circus. And according to a PBS report, the mummy was last seen in public in the late 1970s and may be today in the hands of a private collector. And some of the family members have voiced support for exhuming the body that's buried in John Wilkes Booth grave for a DNA testing, but so far they've been denied that request.
Yeah, it'd be interesting to see what a DNA test would prove. Now, when there was a nephew of John Wilkes Booth that came by the mortician in Enid, Oklahoma, back when the mummy was first on display, and he did not claim the body. So, you know, this is somebody that had, you know, at least, what, maybe 40 years beforehand had seen John Wilkes Booth, maybe about 30 years, but, you know, would not lay claim. And that could be one of those things where, you know, because of, I mean, it would really disrupt, whatever politics are going on at the time, you know, that this was a hidden truth that they basically, you know, I mean, whose body was it that they would have thrown in there? I mean, that would have been a massive cover up at the time.
Yeah.
So for him to actually lay claim, you know, would have been a really big deal back then.
Well, that concludes our presentation on Victorian era photography. Mike, is there anything you want to add or any stories you want to talk about?
I had one more.
Well, go ahead.
Okay. The other one that happened, it was around the same time, because we're, you know, this was kind of, it goes into the, like, the whole, you know, macabre mindset at that time where, you know, there was, like, not really a problem looking at death. We had all the photographs and everything. So the mummies were kind of a sideshow thing that they would do. And it's another Oklahoma tale where he was an outlaw. He wasn't a very good one, Elmer McCurdy. And the only reason why anybody would ever remember the guy is because of what he became after death. You know, the guy was pretty inept at being an outlaw to the point where, you know, he tried to rob a train one time, and, you know, got the times messed up and robbed the wrong one and walked away with just about $46. He was arrested for a number of different things. And, you know, when he died in jail, no, he didn't die in jail. He died in a shootout, with a sheriff, with a deputy sheriff. And, you know, mortician in this town, you know, again, put the body out for somebody to claim, you know, for years, and nobody came by to claim it. And here's just this, again, it's a mummified body that's standing there in this mortician's, you know, place of business. And finally, there were a couple of guys from California that came by and said, yeah, he was our brother. And the mortician wanted the body off his hands, so, let Elmer go with these two guys from California. What they did is they put this mummified body into a sideshow. They covered it in wax.
Oh.
And, they put a noose around him. They were hanging him up, and basically they called him the dummy.
Oh.
Well, decades passed, and people forgot that this was actually a human being, and he passed into, some different circuses and sideshows and things like this. And it was in the 1970s where they were doing filming for the $6 Million Man. And one of the guys from the crew knocked into this dummy that was hanging there because they were doing, I guess it was a carnival episode that they were doing, knocked into the dummy, and the arm fell off. And so he went to go to try to put it back on and noticed that there were bones sticking out of this thing. So there's a whole big to-do about what exactly was this. They figured out, going through the history of it, where this mummy, wasn't a dummy, it was a mummy, where it actually came from. So they brought his body back to a Boot Hill Cemetery where there were a bunch of other outlaws from the time, buried him there. But just kind of interesting, the attitude back then of, just we'll put real human mummies in the sideshows like this.
Oh yeah, and also the freak shows that they had.
Well, yeah, that too.
In that time, they were considered freaks, but they couldn't earn a living. And so they joined the circus because they made good money to help support their families.
Yeah, they had to do something. Yeah, it's really sad, but it's...
Well, that was the way. In the Victorian era, today for us it would be taboo, but in the Victorian era, things were so different. Things were so different, and the way they thought in that at that time.
Yeah, it was definitely very different. Death was more widely accepted, because it happened in the home, in the family all the time. You mentioned earlier about the mourning periods for different ages of children. These days, if you lose a young child that is a couple years old, and you're naturally grieving forever. But back then it was, I hate to say it, but they got over it a lot quicker than, say, an older child. So an older child you've been with for many more years, where deaths of babies, infant deaths, deaths of young children due to illnesses, were a pretty common occurrence. So death in the home was more widely accepted, and a lot of times you had a family cemetery out in the backyard, which we don't have that anymore.
So, oh yeah. The viewers are talking about how the body was able to go into certain positions, but you see, and how, now this is something I didn't even think about. It's true. And when you die, then rigor mortis starts setting in, but I don't think it sets in that fast, and I really did not look that up, because I had thought about, do you know how long it takes?
I used to know that, because I had to I needed that detail for one of my mystery books. It's a certain number of hours rigor sets in, and then after another period of hours it lets loose. So the body's only in rigor for a certain amount of time.
Is that right?
Yeah,
I didn't know that.
And then it's
flexible?
And it'll be flexible again, yep.
Oh, so that's how they got those, some of those, the way the bodies were formed. Like the one little girl, let me show this one. With the little girl that's laying on the floor. Okay, this one here, she's laying on a, her leg is underneath the other leg, and she's like she's asleep on a little child's sofa.
Yeah, any of those photos, I'm sure were taken after Rigger had let loose.
Oh, and then this one too, where the girl is laying on the floor, and I thought, well, goodness, she's lying on the floor like she's sleeping. Now, this to me is an odd picture, with the girl on the floor and the family around her, and they've got the food table set up, and actually some of them are actually smiling, and I thought that was
I don't see it yet, but the one where she's just laying on the floor. Okay, yeah, this one. Yeah, that's really weird, and the teddy bear is all there and everything. Basically, I mean, I'm guessing the food is set up for a funeral. They're probably doing a funeral service. And yeah, there's, you know, a couple of people that are smiling. This might be a little bit of a newer picture, because they wouldn't have been able to hold the smile.
Oh, no, I'm talking about the relatives have smile on their faces. And
yeah,
I thought,
perfect.
Oh, my goodness, I would not be smiling.
No.
Oh,
and again, you know, with photography still being new back then, they might not have etiquette yet designed for how to take a picture in this type of situation. But
okay, well, you know what this picture tells me? This picture is telling me that death, it wasn't that morbid to them. That it was sad, you know. Yes. They passed, but it wasn't, they weren't really that overly sad.
Well, you know, you had very large families back then, and, you know, mortality rate was high, so they were a little more used to death. I mean, sure, it was still sad, and yes, they had these mourning periods and everything, but it was certainly, for lack of a better term, acceptable, just because it happened more often. We were seeing death all the time.
Oh, I hope I'm not offending anybody by showing these post-mortem pictures again. I forgot about that. To me, this is educational.
Yeah, I think you're fine.
Okay, is there anything else you want to add to the show?
I think we covered a lot on this topic. I hope the viewers enjoyed it. I've seen a little bit of the chat, but... it's definitely a fascinating era of early photography. You know, just to be able to see how things were back then, the type of culture, because we tend to forget over time how people acted and reacted to different situations back then.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Understand the context, really, of what they went through. So when we see some of these different images, a lot of people don't understand, and they're like, "Well, why would they do that?" And it's like, "Well, it was different back then."
It was, and their whole attitude was different than ours as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, I mean, when any of my family members passed on, there's no way that never even came to my mind to take a picture of them. Because in my mind is, I don't want to see them like that. And to me, the last time you see them is the last image that sticks in your mind. If you think about somebody that you saw that passed away and how you saw them the last time, that's the image that sticks in your brain. If you see a loved one in the hospital, that's the image that seems to stick. If you see them in an open casket, that image seems to stick, and that's why I could never even think about doing that. That's for me.
Yeah, it's just different these days, because we do have, I mean, on your phone that you hold, you can take all kinds of pictures.
Oh, yeah.
And so, you know, you don't need a picture of the death. Only images they were going to of that person going forward, where these days, you know, you've got like hundreds or maybe even thousands of pictures of that particular loved one. So don't need to do that. So it's, nobody takes those type of pictures anymore.
No. Well, we talked about this one other time, and somebody in the chat said, that they do. That they do take pictures of their passed on loved one, and I believe in their some other states too that they're starting to do this, but I don't know anybody around here that does it. Hey, Mike, they want to know what books you've written.
Quite a few.
I know.
a couple of stories that we mentioned tonight, the John Wilkes Booth story and the Elmer McCurdy story, were out of Ghosts and Legends of Oklahoma. There's that one. There's Ghosts of Maryland. There's Campfire Tales Midwest, Ghost Story and Case Files, Encounters with the Paranormal. Those are all my ghost books. And then I have the two mystery novels, Deadly Airs and System of the Dead. So those are all available at MikeRicksecker.com or on Amazon. And then, of course, I have the YouTube channel for Haunted Road Media, so please go there and subscribe, which contains all kinds of videos. And then Haunted Road Media also has the publishing side, so there's a lot of other books there that are available as well at hauntedroadmedia.com.
Great. And I'm and now you're also a radio show host. What's your show?
Edge of the Rabbit Hole Radio, which is every other Tuesday night. I co-host that with Vanessa Fogel. And next week, Noreen, we have one of your favorite people on, Andrea Perrin.
What is she going to talk about?
We're just going to talk about all kinds of different things. Really, it's going to be a smorgasbord of all things Annie.
So. Oh, God. Oh, she loves to talk about her aliens.
Oh, I know. We'll talk about aliens. One thing I really want to talk to her about is in her books, when they were having the some of the different hauntings at the farmhouse, she talked about how it was like being in a bubble. So I want to talk to her about the bubble.
Okay. Interesting. You should post your show on my channel. Because I don't always see your postings, and please post it on my channel, on my Facebook page.
My Facebook page, yeah.
Okay.
I can do that.
And do you have anything coming up with, now Mike, okay, Mike is one of the team members of
Society of the Supernatural, yes. Yeah.
Yes, Society of the Supernatural with David Weatherly and Dave Spinks. And Mike is the other investigator. And you guys just came off of a fabulous trip.
I was 4 investigations in 4 days. We were run so ragged by the end of that. We were like, what day is this? But it was fantastic. We investigated the Bel Air House, which started as a public investigation. And we did some live footage after that. We live streamed every single place. Randolph County Infirmary, which was just on Nick Groff's show. The Thornhaven Manor, and then Fox Hollow Farms. All those are on the Society of the Supernatural channel, so go check that channel out as well and subscribe there.
Right. I would love to have you guys come back. And each location that you went to, it all has a haunting history, and yeah. I would love to do the history on each location, have you guys come on and talk about your evidence. I would love to do that.
Oh yeah, we got a ton. I mean, just in the just for comparison's sake, nothing bad about Nick Groff. I think he's a great investigator. But you watch his show that he had at the Randolph County Infirmary. It's an hour long show, and it's like you got a little bit of evidence. But the first half an hour that we did at that infirmary, and you can go watch the video. The first half an hour, we're getting all kinds of stuff. So we tend to get a lot of evidence.
Oh, you guys are good together. You are really good together. I love you guys.
So, and we do have the events at the end of April at Old Sulphur Springs. So, still a few tickets available for that. So, check out that as well. I know I've posted, Dave Spinks has been posting it all over in his page. So, get the info for that and come check us out down there.
Oh, yeah. Awesome. Okay, Mike. Hey, Mike, thanks so much for being with me tonight. I enjoyed this topic a lot, and I'd love to have you back on the show again.
Yeah, absolutely. Anytime.
Thanks, Mike. Good night.
Good night. And thanks, Maureen. Good night.
Good night. Thank you. Okay, everybody. I'm going to contact Dave. He is at the Valeska House, and he wants to come on my show. He's with Carissa Fleck, and they're going to be going live. I was waiting for a phone call from Dave. Let me see. Hold on. Let me see if I can get him, okay? Just hold on, everybody. Because Dave is supposed to be doing an live investigation tonight at the Valeska House. And I'm going to get him on. So you guys, everybody, can you just hold on for a minute? Let me go call him. Hold on. I'll be right back. Oh, let me hold on. I'll be right back. Oh, yes. Okay, let me get everybody. Oh, hey, everybody. Okay, let me, here, Mike, let me fix this. Hold on for a second. Oh, my God. It went off again. Hold on. Hold on. Let me get Dave back. He won't understand. Sorry, guys. I don't know what's wrong with this computer. Hold on. I'm sorry. Gosh, I can't believe it's doing this.
Hello?
Oh, yeah, my computer went off. It's restarting.
Okay, I thought I was like, my home wasn't mine.
Oh, yeah, no, the Mac.
I'm going to hang up because we don't want to have double calls.
Okay, yeah, no, it's completely restarting, so... I'll get you back as soon as it restarts, okay?
Okay.
Okay, bye. Sorry, guys. I don't know what's wrong with this. All right, hold on. Let's see. Is Raven still in the chat room? Probably not. All right. Oh. hold on. Come on. Ah, here we go. Sorry. Oh, there's Spooky. Hey, everybody. Spooky Raven has a show on Tuesday nights. What is it, Spooky? Anything But Ordinary. And she is on YouTube. And so please join her on Tuesday nights for Anything But Ordinary. She has different topics every week. Okay. Hey, Dave.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, hold on.
You got me?
Yep, gotcha.
Gotcha.
Awesome.
Awesome.
I'm getting the feedback, yeah. That's all.
Cool.
Awesome. Okay. How are we looking?
Oh, yeah, okay. You're all green. It looks awesome.
Well, it has to be green because we have no lighting in this house.
Okay, well, tell everybody where you are.
Are we on?
Yes.
Oh, hey, everybody.
Hi.
We are at the Velisca Axe Murder House in Velisca, Iowa.
Yep. It's going to be awesome. This is somewhere I've always wanted to go.
Crazy.
Oh, my God. I've been after Dave for, I don't know how many, couple of years to please go there.
Oh, yeah. Well, we're here.
Oh, I'm so excited. I'm so excited. So how long have you been in that location today?
We got here about 4, I think it was.
Yeah.
3 or 4. We hung out with Johnny Hauser for a while, and, you know, he filled us in on some of his experiences here and told us about other folks' experiences in the house. Pretty crazy stuff.
Yep, definitely.
Anything going on? Anything happening?
Oh, yeah. When we first came in after, you know, we left and we went and got something to eat and stuff like that. And when we were bringing the equipment in, Carissa, tell them about what you heard.
A little girl giggling.
You didn't.
Yeah,
I was actually taking out the shadow baby because I figured this would be a perfect location for them. And as I was taking the doll out, I heard a little girl giggling, and Dave came in, and I was, like, talking to the little girl.
Oh.
That was after she was out doing her thing.
Yeah.
And I came in, I was just loading equipment in, and I heard a woman talk. I couldn't make out what she said, but it was definitely an older, I wouldn't say an older woman, but a mature woman.
Oh.
You know? And we've heard a couple of weird things, a couple of bangs, stuff like that. I don't know if you guys know, but upstairs in the one bedroom, there is still an axe mark on the back of the wall where he chopped up the parents. When he reached back with the axe, there's a big freaking dent in the wall, and it's still there from 1912.
Now, is that the master bedroom?
Yes.
Yeah.
And now, the master bedroom kind of slopes down, right?
Not really.
It doesn't? I thought it kind of sloped down.
No, well, it's a really weird design of the ceiling. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're right. It does slope. It has an angle.
Yeah, an angle.
It has a little bit of an angle on
yeah,
it.
Yeah, now because they thought the person, because they had, they were thinking about several people who might have done the murder, but they said if that person had lifted that axe up, they would have obviously touched the ceiling.
Mm-hmm.
And so it couldn't have, it had to have been somebody that was at a certain height for them to lift that axe up and then take it down.
Yeah. Yeah, that was one of the first things I was doing was trying to figure out how tall the guy was when we were up there, because I was measuring and I was like doing like this, and I said, well, he had to be around my size. Johnny's a little bit taller than me. And for him to reach back where the mark was, you know, it's pretty creepy location. You know, 8 people died here.
Oh, yeah.
It's just horrendous. And this little tiny house, it's tiny.
Yes.
Right in front of us, directly in front of us, was where 2 people were murdered in this bedroom to my left. two kids, and the axe was found right against that wall right there.
Yeah.
Directly in front of us.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we're sitting in the living room right now.
Yeah, I heard that house was really small. So, what do you...
600 square feet.
Mm-hmm.
So, how long do you have the... How long are you going to be there tonight?
I'm going to be here till like 11 in the morning.
Oh, my God. All night?
Well, I don't know if we'll actually... I mean, we have the house till that time, but we'll probably leave around 5.
Wow.
Because we're leaving here tomorrow, and yep. We're going to another awesome location. It's a surprise. We're not going to say where it's at, but Sunday night we'll be live again.
Yep.
Another crazy location in the Midwest.
Oh, my God. I can't.
Last night we had a few issues streaming, but we did put some stuff on our Facebook. So mm-hmm. We live streamed on Facebook. If you want to check that out, we were at the Farrar School.
Which is another crazy active location. That location actually freaked me out, Noreen.
Oh, my God.
I think that's the first time Dave's seen me not really want to go anywhere alone.
Yeah, I was trying to get her help because I was like, what are you doing?
Oh.
It's weird there. I don't know if it's the kid ghost thing or what, but I didn't like being there at all.
Oh, my God. That's crazy to hear that coming from you because you are, yeah.
It is kind of crazy.
Yeah, what we have here, Johnny gave to us is an actual copy of the actual newspaper.
All right, hold on. Let me get a close-up of that. Hold on.
All right, I'll put it up on my camera.
All right, I'm giving them a close-up of it. That's the oh my God, that's the newspaper?
Yeah, it's a copy of the original.
Oh.
And here it has some of the people's pictures, see?
Wow. Oh, wow.
Here's some of the kids.
Oh, yeah.
Poor little things.
Oh, my God, Dave. So
here's one of the suspects.
Yeah, now who was that one? Is that the preacher?
That's Reverend Kelly.
The preacher.
Yeah, so, you know, look at the little babies right there.
Yeah, I don't know how anybody could do
that. It's just a disgusting crime.
Yeah, it is. This whole house just feels very sad.
It is.
Kind of like a confusing vibe to it, too.
Yeah.
Like, we've been kind of in a fog.
Yeah, you know, one of the reasons I wanted to, you know, this place has been on my bucket list for many years. I just never got a chance to come over here and... You know, being ex-law enforcement and stuff, I just, you know, sometimes I hope to get some answers. Of maybe, you never know, we might get a name that, or something that may lead to something, you know?
Oh, Dave, yes, I hope you get something tonight. I really do. This is one of my, I did a show on this several years ago, and this house is one of my favorites. Because of the mystery with it. Nobody, it's an unsolved case, and I really hope that you can get some answers tonight.
Now, Johnny told us, too, today that, you know, he's here 24/7, so he said he has, on numerous devices that he's used, he's got pretty much every single name that was ever a suspect.
Yep.
And it leaves you with more questions, so... It's just one of those locations. The crime will probably never be solved, and that could lead the children's spirits and the spirits here not to ever rest, in my opinion. You know, that could be one of the reasons for the haunting here.
Yeah. Do you guys have any questions for Dave and Carissa? Anybody have any questions for them? So Dave, what are you guys going to start out doing tonight? What equipment are you going to be using?
Everything. We're going to be using ghost boxes. We're going to be doing EVP sessions. We're probably going to put some laser grids up.
Mm-hmm. Shadow babies.
Shadow babies for the kids that Carissa brought are really cool and creepy as hell.
I love them. I use them now everywhere. Trip wires.
Tell them how the shadow baby works.
The shadow baby, I don't know if you've seen the videos on the Demons in Seattle case, but what they are shadow detecting devices, and they are put inside a baby doll, and when a shadow walks in front of them, they giggle and laugh and move. It's really creepy and awesome. And kid spirits tend to really like them.
Yeah, because they're a doll baby.
Yep.
You know, so, you know, you try to use different things, trigger objects like that to get responses, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my God! So what time does your investigation? Now, where do we find the link?
As soon as we get done here, I will send it to you. You can post it on your Facebook. It's going to be on my Facebook, Carissa's Facebook. I'll share it with everybody.
Yep.
Please share it. Everybody, come over. I had to start. I'll have a new link for my Real Supernatural channel. I had some problems again. I had to start a whole new channel. So it's still called Real Supernatural, Real Space Supernatural. But everybody, come over and please subscribe again. As everyone knows, I have a lot of problems with YouTube and other things. So it's just one of those things. We'll get worked out and ironed out. Excuse me. So it is what it is, you know. We love what we do. We're not going to stop what we do.
And nope, never. There's nothing that's going to stop us. And I think you're on the same boat as us, Noreen.
Oh, yeah.
We all love what we do, you know, and we do
nothing,
this.
Nothing can stop us. Nothing can stop us.
Oh, no.
No.
Especially not anything so insignificant as what it's attempting to.
Yeah, so we're going to, with that being said, you know, we're going to keep doing what we do because we love to share in our adventures and our investigations with all of our fans and the people who enjoy, who don't get to do what we do. That's why we do the live streams, you know?
Well,
if it wasn't for the fans and everyone else, the live streams mean nothing to, you know, it's for them, mostly.
Yep.
So,
well,
know, that's where we're at.
And then, see, especially tonight, you're going to a location I've always wanted to go to but never got there. And I am so going to enjoy this investigation tonight.
Well, we'll do our best for you guys, you know, as well as we do. Sometimes you get crazy stuff, sometimes you don't get anything. It's the way the cookie crumbles. In the paranormal.
Yep.
We are going to be utilizing something a little different tonight. We're going to be using a wireless full-spectrum DVR system.
Which is awesome.
And we have different cameras set up around the house as stations, you know, like camera 1, 2, 3, and 4, so and so on. We will be going like that, and the live camera feed will be on the monitor, so we can just do whatever we need to do without dragging the camera around and all that stuff. So.
Oh, my God. That's going to be crazy. Wow. Oh, I'm so excited. So, what time do you think the investigation's going to start?
Probably give us about 20, 30 minutes and give us time to post the link up and all that stuff and set up YouTube and all that.
It's going to be an awesome night. All
right.
Going to get a lot of crazy stuff.
Also, I'll tell everyone that's watching now, if for some reason the camera goes or the screen goes black, it's usually a battery change. If something crazy goes and then we lose the feed, we'll start another one. So, that's just what'll happen. And we'll keep on going.
Yep.
Awesome. Are you excited?
Oh, yeah. We're pumped.
Oh, my God. I can't wait. All right. So, everybody, I'll be posting. Dave's going to post on my Facebook page. I'm going to post in Google+, and we'll spread the word out where Dave is tonight on his new channel. And we should be in for a fabulous, awesome investigation tonight with Carissa and Dave.
Awesome.
Yep, it's going to be great.
Thanks right. for sharing. We love you guys. And
yep,
we'll see
we
you
do.
Soon. See you soon.
Bye. All right.
Okay, so thank you so much for coming on the show. And we will see you later then, Dave. So please get ready to set up so we can watch you.
Absolutely.
Yep, that's the plan.
Okay. Thanks so much. Have a good time and good luck to you and be safe, okay?
All right. See you soon.
Thank
Bye.
You. Bye, guys. Bye.
Bye.
Oh, my God. I'm so excited. So, everybody, I'll be posting all over for Dave's live stream. He'll be, I guess in about 20 minutes, he'll be ready for the show. And Valeska House, oh my God. I've never seen a live show at the Valeska House, and I'm so excited. So everybody, thank you so much for being here with us tonight. And I hope you liked the show. It was something different. Oh, I forget. I don't have my calendar. I forget who my guest is next week. I know I got a good one. Next week, April 4th, I think it is. I got a really good guest. Let me see if I can find it. Hold on. Let's see. Oh, Jeremy Leonard is coming back with Joy Stinson. That was the demonic haunting with the mother and her children, with all that horrible demonic voice and the possession that took place in that house. The mother is actually coming on the show next week, and I'm really excited about that. That was an excellent show. So I hope you join me next week. And let's see. Oh, my God. Then the following week after that, it's a Corpsewood Manor. It was a murder that was in Georgia. They called it the Corpsewood Manor because, anyway, it's a long story to it. And I actually, after I did that show, I got a message from a Matt Battle, and he is a sheriff in that area, and he is aware of what actually happened at that manor, and about the killings, and about everything that was going on leading up to that. And he sent me a video that was actually captured by a sheriff that was there at the murder scene. And I haven't seen it yet, but I'm going to show some clips out of that CD. I can't wait for that. Then on the 21st, Dave and I are doing another... No, Dave and David Weatherly and myself, we're doing another missing persons story. And this one is... Oh, my God. I'm not telling you what it is. It's going to be awesome. And then on the 28th, the last day of April, we're going to do... that Mike Fleeman wants to come back, and he wants to do another true crime. Hey, guys, I got to ask you something. I have to ask you something. And please let me know, because I don't want to offend anybody. But Mike wants to do a show. You know, he writes true crime, and he's been involved in real-life court cases, like O.J. Simpson is one of them. He knows the whole thing about the O.J. Simpson, because he was there. He was a journalist. But he wanted to do a show on mothers. There's four famous cases of these women who killed their children. And I don't know if... I don't want to offend anybody by doing something like that. So I need to know if that's acceptable, or I can change that to another topic. But this was his suggestion to me. If mothers who kill their children, and I don't know the story, they've all been on TV. I can't remember the four women that were involved in that, but they're all well-known cases. I need to know if this is going to offend anybody. Really? You guys won't get offended? I don't want anybody to get upset because I'm doing a show like that. Okay. Oh, Mike, Haunted Roads Media, Mike's in. Hey, Mike. Okay, all right. So then I'll, yes, Casey Anthony, he knows all about that. All right. Okay, I'll do it then. I just don't want to offend anybody. All right, so let's do some shout-outs so I can get ready, because I want to get something to eat before I watch the live at the Valeska House with Dave and Carissa. I'm so excited. All right, let me do some shout-outs. Hold on, everybody. Where's Royce? Okay, let's do a shout-out to Haunted Roads Media, which is Mike Ricksecker, Jen LL, The Batsonator, Jimmy Cortez. Hi, Jimmy. Margarita Harveth. Wait a minute, guys. Scott Lockwood. Oh, my God. Here we go. Oh, you guys drive me crazy. Scott Lockwood, Donna Gordon, Angel Simmons, Griffin Corcoran. Sorry, Griffin. Summer Sins, Unique Sweet Annie, I See Lies, The Unseen Scene, Midnight Emirata, Hi Honey, Janet W., Maria Hyatt, Janet Bolt, Jeanette Brown, Super Witchy Gamer, Michael Issa, Zoe Small, that's my kitty's name, Zoe. Mom Tube, oh God, wait a minute, guys. Oh my God, you guys. Christine Phyllis. Donella Daywood, Sean, is that it, Sean? Karate Sean? Bodine, right? Phil M. Lucas, oh God, I just lost it. Oh my God, it was Lucas. Oh dear. Lucas Langner, David Coffin, hi David. B-Singer 11, Sleepy-Faced Angel. Sarah Farnham, hey, some of you are new. Oh, thanks, Sarah, for joining me. Please subscribe and join us every week. Mondays and Thursdays, I have a live show. But you know what? Carissa is on a road trip with Dave, so we're not going to have the horsefly experiment on Monday. Okay, so, but I will have my show on Thursday. Yes, Maria Hyatt, I did, honey. Come share a little with me. The live show is here on my channel every Thursday. If you go to the main page where it says here, Paranormal Zone Do You Believe web series right here, all you have to do is click on that and it'll bring you to my main channel. And I have my events up. I haven't done it yet for the next show, but that's where I have my live events. You can also get a notification from me for the live shows. You have to go to my website at paranormalzone.tv and go to the email and get on the email list, and I send out reminders the day of the show. Caria Brown, Deb Gale, Lily Villalobos. Yeah, Mike, thanks so much, honey. Have a great weekend. I want Mike back on again. I love Mike. Susie Farrell. Hey, Royce, there you are. Hey, thank you. Thanks, Royce, so much for being my mod every week. Desert Deity. Lynn Bowling. Oh, gosh, I just lost somebody. Darn it, darn it. Oh gosh, Lewis something. K.L. Carrie Y. Emma Aviano. Laws Coy. Lucas Langner, I said that. Okay, anybody else want to shout out? There's still 93 people. Oh, thanks, Mike. Thanks, I will. Yeah, Mike's really cool. He is. Anybody else want to shout out? I'd be happy to. We still have a lot. We had over 100 people tonight. 110. Thanks, everybody. Thanks so much. Did you guys like the topic tonight? Hi, Los. Para Princess Patricia. Hi. Hi, there you are, Ginger. I knew I saw you. You always hide at the last minute. River Culver. Yes, River. Hi, honey. Oh, yeah. Mike, the Society of the Supernatural. Heather L.A., Carl White. Anybody else? Oh, Nancy Soplavita. Anybody else want a shout out? Oh, okay. Yeah, can you imagine? Carissa was scared. That's so unlike her. Anita Ackerman, there you are, Anita. Sandra Miller. See, I know you guys are hiding because there's still quite a few people. Elaine Michael. Yeah, Oh, sea black. I love the old photographs as well, and I love the Victorian era. I'll think of some other shows of that era. I know we could come up with something. Oh no. Well, hopefully Betsinator, it didn't have anything to do with tonight's show. Anybody else want to shout out? Okay, I'm gonna get something to eat. I made some soup. I'm hungry for that. And oh yeah, Lully Tooby. I thought I said hi to you, honey. Lully Tooby. Donella, Dave and about Jenna Brown. Dave, in about 20 minutes, yes, is going to have a live paranormal investigation at the Valeska House. If you don't know anything about the Valeska House, Google it. Oh, Kelly's there? Oh, Kelly was there. Oh, Griffin, I didn't see Kelly. Oh, let's see. I don't want to screw this up. Oh, thanks, Royce. I think I did this right. Okay. Yeah, I'm really looking forward to this weekend. I'm going to have some fun with my daughter. And so, everybody, I hope you had a nice Easter last week. We had a ball. And watch for my... watch if you... Hey, you know... If you want to be friends with me on Facebook, it's Noreen St. Pierre Balovich. You can find me there. I am going to post for Dave's show as soon as he puts the event up. I'm going to post on my Facebook page, and I will post. Oh, and hey, guys, I have a like page. It's Royce. Maybe Royce can show it. It's, oh, my God, what is it? It's, I think it's called the Do You Believe fan page. Would you guys go over there and give my page a like? I also post my shows there, too. Don't forget, you can sign up for reminders at paranormalzone.tv and go over to the email and sign up, and I'll send you out a show reminder. And so, everybody, I'm going to go. Thank you. I mean, really, thank you all so much for joining me every week. I really appreciate it. Thanks to all the new viewers that are coming on every week. I appreciate that as well. We do a live show every Thursday, but we've also added a Monday. But this Monday, Chris is not around, so there won't be any live show on Monday, okay? And so I will see you, though, on Thursday, okay? And everybody, thanks so much. I love you guys. You mean an awful lot to me, and I wouldn't be doing this if it wasn't for you. Okay, so I love you, and thank you so much. I really appreciate it. Good night, everybody. Be safe. Have a great weekend, okay? I love you. Good night.